let's go ahead and begin our worship with prayer this morning and lift up this time to Him. Heavenly Father, we praise You. We thank You, Lord, for Your goodness to us. We look over the last week, Lord, and the way that You intervened when we allowed You to, and then the times that You intervened, Lord, where we were obstinate and finding our own way. Lord, we look back and we say thank You. We praise You, Lord, for dealing with us sinners in a way, Lord, that we can only give You praise. Again, Father, we lift up this time to You, this time of praise. We commit it to You. We ask for Your Spirit to be here because we want You here. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all stand together this morning. As some of you know, we had an incredible baptism service last week. And that was awesome and great to be a part of. And if you were a part of it last week, you got a t-shirt. And Remy, you can go ahead and stand. Remy's wearing his t-shirt this week. It says that he is a new life. Thank you so much. You can sit down. But I'm going to have you stand here again. Not only do you get a t-shirt, but this is a plaque that reminds you of that Sunday and that commitment that you made to Christ. And you can open it up. I think you open it from this side right here. It's got that bubble wrap. Don't be popping it in church. Ryan, did you hear me? You got it, man. Remy said thank you. And Haley, you can open that if you want. And this is for Athena and Jordan and Amber. There we go. You got it. Let's give them a hand. This is for Athena. Okay. Isn't that sweet? Let me see it. This, you know, Jill did this. This is her stuff. And then you just, that's for you. And then you slide that. Isn't that neat? It says, "For He shall give us angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways." Psalms 91 and verse 11. And it's got Haley's name right there and the date of her baptism and a little picture. A couple pictures there if you like the other one better. Here we go. Remy got that as well. Praise the Lord. And we have another baptism coming up here within a month. So if you missed out on this one, month and a half, more like a month and a half. That's right. Within a month, we have Easter at the end of the year or at the end of the month. And then we're going to have another baptism. Turn to Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1. And verse 16, one of the things that we've been going through over the last several weeks is we've been going over certain passages. I would say it's probably been the last couple of months, passages that need to be a part of our life, passages that we have memorized, that when Satan comes to attack or our flesh is weak or the world is leaning in on us, that we go to these passages, and I call them standalone passages, because if they're, you know, they're not in context, they still say exactly what it means. And this week we're running into another passage that is what I also call a standalone passage. This is Romans chapter 1 and verse 16, and let me read it to you. "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also for the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith." Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I thank You, Lord, for Your goodness. And it is running after us in such a way that, Lord, we could not have conceived. And it's something that You gave us, Lord. And we praise You for that. We thank You so much for the gift of salvation that You have given. We thank You in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, this past Wednesday, we had 17 men on Wednesday night. And if your man is not coming or you're here and you're not coming, you need to be a part of that. It is an incredible time of openness and sharing with one another. The topic came up of persecution, being persecuted for righteousness. There's blessings that come with the Beatitudes as we've walked through the second season of The Chosen and the study, and this particular one was, "Blessed are the," are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is, present tense, the kingdom of heaven. The only other one in the Beatitudes, 8 verses, is the first one that says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And as we went through that, I asked the question, I said, how many of you have been persecuted for righteousness' sake? You can think about that this morning as well, too. How many of you have been persecuted for righteousness' sake? Anybody today say, I can remember a situation where I was persecuted for righteousness' sake? Amen. You know that you are being used by the Holy Spirit to do something or to not do something, as the case may be, and the world or your own flesh or the devil reached out and attacked you for what you were doing. And I think a lot of us would say yes. Some of us are just shy or modest, as the case may be. On Wednesday night, one guy who's not shy or modest is Christian, and he's not here this morning, so we're going to give him a hard time. But he spoke up. He spoke up very quickly, and he said, I was persecuted a couple of times. The one time that he was mentioning was within the past year, and he was on a cruise, working the cruise, and he was doing his quiet time one morning, and a young lady who also worked the cruise was walking by him, saw him reading his Bible, and began to attack him for what he believed. And basically her question to him was this: how can a good God send someone like me to hell? So at least she knew where she was going. You know, a lot of people don't even know where they're going, so she had already gotten that taken care of. Why would a good God send me to hell? Was the question. But it bothered her so much that she came back a second time later on when she saw him doing his quiet time again and attacked him. And Christian, just very open, honest with us, looked at us and said, what would you say to her? You know, what should I have said? And after several of, this is the beauty of men's Bible study. We had 17 men last week. Mel mentioned what he would do, what he would say. And that way we strengthen one another so we're prepared for the next opportunity when this comes up. Because in the world, you're going to have tribulation. You're going to be and have your faith tested. It is a reality. And we need to be ready to respond to the questions that come to us. And my summation after I walked away, and we mentioned to him the fact that whenever somebody says something like that, they're missing the boat on a couple of different areas. Number one, Romans 3 says all have sinned. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But for her, she was under the impression that God was doing something to her unjust. Because the reality is, she had a particular sin in her life that she wanted to enjoy. And she thought there was nothing wrong with it. There was no shame in it at all. And why would God send me to hell for this sin that I am participating in? I think is okay. I don't feel any guilt over it. I don't think anything's wrong. Probably my parents and grandparents did the same sin. That's not fair. That's not right. And what she did not understand is, in choosing to live in this particular way, she was making a statement: I want to be separate from God, and I want to enjoy my sin. And God, his wrath is real. His wrath, you can read, look at verse 18. If you opened your Bibles this morning, look at Romans 1:18 and what it says. But it doesn't come without reason or cause. God is holy. God is righteous. There's so many different things that we can say to an individual like this, but the reality is the Holy Spirit has to work on the heart of somebody to bring them to the place where they realize, I should have shame. I should have guilt in this area. That is the work of the Holy Spirit. But the question was posed right here, and this is the question, or excuse me, the statement that Paul makes. Paul, he doesn't say this. He doesn't say, you should not be ashamed of the gospel of Christ. He doesn't say, like I would probably say, if I was preaching this and I wasn't Paul, which I'm not even close, I would say, we should not be ashamed of the gospel of Christ. That's what I would say. But Paul didn't say that, did he? He said, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Where does that come from? Where does shame, how did shame and the gospel get connected together? Why are they connected together? That doesn't make sense to me. Shame and the gospel, Why is there shame? Why is there persecution? What is God doing? He sees a group of people headed towards a Christless eternity, headed towards hell. And he says what? He comes into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Why does that need shame? Why is there shame given to Christ? Because of what he did. Go over to Isaiah 53. Isaiah 53 and verse 3. Listen to what it says. Good man, Richard. NIV says, he was despised and rejected by humanity. He was despised and rejected by mankind. A man of suffering and familiar with pain, like one from whom people hid their faces, he was despised. And we held him in low esteem. That's us, those who are saved at one point in our life. It goes down to verse 4. Look at verse 4, the second half of verse 4. It says this, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. Christ was one who suffered for our righteousness. Christ was one who was despised. Shame was heaped on him. Why does that, and how does that make sense at all? The perfect, holy one of God sent to earth on our behalf, and he bears shame. Why is that? Well, he bore shame for us. Look at the rest of the verse here in Isaiah 53. Listen to what it says. Verse 5 says this, but he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. Verse 6 is that famous verse. We'll probably go over this passage again come Easter. It says this, we all like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, but the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. The shame that we should feel, the shame and guilt and the dirtiness we should feel was piled on Christ. Therefore, whenever you go out into the world and you identify with the person of Christ and you say, I am a Christian, you are going to receive the punishment, or you're going to receive the lashing out of the world simply by identification. If you are one of his, Christ says this in the book of John. He says, listen, a pupil is not beyond his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. And that shame that he received on your behalf, you also will experience that shame as well too. But Paul said this, I'm not ashamed. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, not of God. Guys, I want you to do me a favor. I want you to fight the tendency to out in public talk about God. Is that okay? Because God could be anything. When you say God, they could be like, oh yes, the universe does think that way. You could say God, they're thinking, oh yeah, my higher power. Right? Well, God, oh yeah, Allah. God, oh yeah, Buddha. They're thinking of all. You get specific. You speak about the Son of God. It's hard to speak about the name of Jesus, isn't it? It's hard to talk about your identity that you have with him. Now, do you feel the shame? Now, do you understand the shame that's attached to you and attached to him as well? And that's why Paul says this, I'm not ashamed. I'm not ashamed of the good news of Christ. I'm not ashamed. Shame is one of the first things that we need to experience before we come to Christ, isn't it? Shame is something that we should have, shame and guilt. Always note the person who's defending their sin to you. If they're angry at you because you're a Christian, chances are they're probably a lot closer to Christ than other people who are just kind of complacent about the whole subject. I like it when somebody's upset. That means something's getting in and maybe the Holy Spirit is working in their heart. So don't sweat it. If you're persecuted for the cause of Christ, if you're identifying with him and you receive the shame that he received, Paul says this, look, I cannot wait to get to Rome. Look at verse 15, because I'm going to speak the gospel. Now, when I think of the gospel, we always think of what? We think of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, don't we? That is the gospel. That's what the gospel is. But as Paul unfolds the gospel in Romans, it seems to be something added to that as well, too. Here he says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. Why? What does it say? Look at verse 16. What does it say? It is the power of God unto or to salvation. To who? Who gets that power? Those who what? Those who believe. It is the power of God unto salvation. Anybody this morning, you're a believer, you trust in Christ, and there's things in your life that you need to be delivered from. You're a believer. Oh, so believers still need to be delivered and saved from different things in their life, right? Well, praise God. There's the power of God for you who believes. How many of you have been praying for something to be delivered out of your life or to be saved from something for years and years, and it still hasn't gone away, and you haven't received that power? Have you ever asked God, what's going on? Why am I still dealing with fear or porn or you fill in the blank, whatever it is in your life. I want to be delivered from this. I know that it's wrong. And Lord, your word says it's the power of God unto salvation to those who believe. Why am I not being delivered? Have you ever asked that question? Have you ever come to God and asked him that question? What's going on in your life that causes there not to be power? There should be power. The mark of a believer is that we have power. What is necessary to receive that power? Look at the rest of the verse. Look what it says here, verse 15. It's the power of God to salvation to everyone who believes. And here, this is the way it came. It came through Christ. And when he came to the nation of Israel, and he delivered the message of him being the Messiah to take away the sin of the world. And it says, who did it come to first? It came to the Jew, didn't it? It came to the Jewish people, for the Jew first, and also for the Greek. And that's another way of saying for everybody else. If you listen to Jewish people, they will say there's Jews and Gentiles, right? So that's for all of us. Salvation came not just for the Jewish individual, but it came for everybody else as well, too. Salvation is there for us. Hey, don't forget the question I posed. Why isn't there victory in your life? Right? Why isn't the power of the gospel flowing over into your life in certain areas? Continue to remember that. It goes on to say this. This gospel, for in it, the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just will live by faith. Now listen, let's go ahead and explain that. From faith to faith is another way of you living out your life, trusting in him, right? And he does something in your life. You recognize it, and you recognize it was from him. And then you move over, and you're in another situation, and it scares you. You need to be delivered. But you think back to the last time you trusted in him by faith. He delivered you. And you think to yourself, the same God who delivered me then, he can deliver me now. That's what it means, simplified. From faith, you experienced faith, you experienced deliverance, to faith, meaning you exercise your faith again. What does it look like when you're exercising your faith? What happens when a believer has victory in one area and then, my goodness, all of a sudden they start slipping and falling back into sin in an area? How does that work its way out? What takes place when that's happening, and what can God do to turn it around and to transform it? I'm not ashamed. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. It's the good news of Christ. It's the power of God to what? To salvation. To those who what? To believe. What is involved in believing? Think about the concept. What is involved in believing? There's a lot of stuff that's involved in believing, isn't it? Belief isn't just a word that stands alone all by itself. It means trust. Another thing we always talk about is sometimes it means relying on him, depending on him. I like the word trust, though. I like the word trusting in him. All right. Can we get some power this morning? We have power for lights, but it's not affecting some of the lights. Look at that. That's about 7 or 8. You know, I'm glad, because I like the smoking lounge kind of view of thing. I got an old. Yours has the little clip, doesn't it? Greg, your old man light, does it come off your hat? It does. I think we have like 4 or 5 old men in our Bible study. Is it that many? See, we all judge old and age in a different way. When you're 60, Mel's not that old, you know? Mel needs a light. Guess what I bought? I bought the best light. I've killed you guys. You're not old yet? You don't need it. Why don't you need a light when we read? You just don't read. You got it memorized, right? You just use your phone. Oh, do you have the chosen material on the phone? Okay, there you go. Uses it. But that's clunky. You have to hold on to it. I have one that fits around my neck and has two little lights. You're going to want one. Matter of fact, I bought two, right? So listen, how do we receive power? Not like the little light power, but how do we receive this power? What needs to happen? What needs to take place? God's word says in Colossians, it says this, as you have received Christ Jesus the Lord, we talked about this on Wednesday, so walk you in him. What happened when you received Christ for the first time? What did it look like? Well, probably you came to a place where you realized you were a sinner in need of a Savior. I have a problem in this area, and I need God to help me. I need him to deliver me. Well, I was talking to Philip, who's not here. We got to get on him. Right? Oh, it's been a big 3 weeks. I need a break from church. You don't think the pastor says the same thing? No laughs. No one can get a break from church. Well, as Philip and I were talking, we were talking about something that we've been mentioning for a while now, and it's prayer. And how do we get a hold of God through prayer? And I just asked him the question. I said, Philip, whenever I do this, and we've talked about it in church, what is this a sign of? And Philip said, he said, it's a sign of you holding out your hand and holding on to God's hand. And I didn't address it at the time, because you don't always address everything. But I thought, yeah, kind of, but no. Because I did that for the longest time. I would go into a grocery store. I realized I was going to meet people. And with people, you're going to have a problem, right? So you need God. So I would take my hand, and I would reach out, and I would hold on to his hand. But something happened. That stopped working, and I would open my hand halfway through, you know, going through Publix or whatever, and it just didn't have the power. What do we need in our life? We need power. So I've been talking to you and Pastor McGee at the end of the men's Bible study. As the men were putting the chairs away, he said, hey, Pastor Dave was talking about the problem that we have when we drive. Are you guys working on that problem? And a lot of men are like, I have a problem when I drive. You know, I'm having an issue. He says, are you seeing deliverance in that area? It's one thing to address the problem. It's one thing to be poor in spirit and say, I have an issue here. It's another thing to get the power, to get the transformed life, to get the change. So is there a change going on in your life? I want you to know that I've experienced change in my life. And I will just tell you what God has been teaching me. I've been praying for years, praying for people. Betty and I talk about it. We fight in prayer. And when you start fighting in prayer, everything you need to do comes in your mind and you... Well, what I've learned is keep fighting. Stay there. Don't leave. Stay in prayer. Continue to ask God for help. Don't walk away. As soon as you catch yourself thinking about other things, start praying again and focusing on him. But as I've been praying, I've been hearing from God. Don't just pray. I need you to worship me. I need you to worship. And here's what I want you to do. Stop holding my hand, and I want you to open your hand. What does it mean when I open my hand? It means a lot of things. Zion will tell you. We talked about this a couple weeks ago, right? When my hand is open, Zion says, you're praying. But I'm doing more than praying. I'm meditating on the presence of God being in the room. But as I start to meditate on the presence of God being in the room, I'm also realizing that I need him. And I'm also realizing that he's holy and he's perfect. And then the next thing I realize is my hand is open in worship, in praise to him. I'm realizing I can't do it without you. I'm going to keep my hand here, and I'm going to keep, you are holy, and you're in the room. And then I hear him say, you need to submit to me. You need to make me the Lord of your moment right now. Let me be Lord of this moment. Submit, yield, give me the moment. For years, I struggled with fear. Fear about what could happen. Fear about what might happen. Fear about, oh man, I've been here before. This can be a problem. Immediately it takes me into meditative worship where I open my hand and I acknowledge, I must submit to you. Is he Lord? Oh, he is. Is he powerful? Is he holy? Okay, here's the problem. Can I trust him? Will I trust him? My hand is open in worship, acknowledging who he is, but will I yield to him to let him be who he is and give him the problem or the situation? Can I yield to him? Can I submit to him? That's what the open hand means. I'm worshiping you. You're holy, you're righteous, you're powerful. I submit to you. All right, how does that work practically? Well, we're coming back from track meet yesterday. I love my kids. They're great illustrations for me. And Stone's driving, but for some reason, even though Stone's driving and I'm not, my hand is open. What does this mean? I'm praying. What else? I'm worshiping him. I'm meditating. I realize he's in the room. And I'm actively saying, I trust you with this moment right now. But the problem is, Stone's driving. Stone's driving. So what can I do? What can I do? Well, we get to the bottom of the off-ramp at 54, right there. And Stone has already suggested Burger King. And I'm like, yes. You know, Burger King needs a space for me. It needs about a month or two. And then I'm ready to hit it again. Love Burger King. It's good. I oftentimes have to microwave the meat before I can eat it, go home. But anyway, Burger King's awesome. So we're at the bottom of the off-ramp. You right with me? What's my hand doing? Praying for what? Burger King? No, I'm secure, Burger King. I think God's going to handle Burger King for me. But getting there might be an issue. Lo and behold, the guy behind us was impatient. Who's driving? Stone. Everybody wave at Stone. Beeps on the horn. And I can see Stone getting angry. Where does Stone get that? Where does Stone get that? Stone gets it from his dad. I've been showing him the wrong way for years. So Stone, I can see what I've nurtured in him start to well up inside of him. And I tell him, Stone, Jesus is in the car right now. Stone, we have to trust in him. Stone, vengeance is mine. I will repay, says Stone. No, says the Lord. See, that's why these standalone verses are so important. I'm sitting there praying, and Lord, I need you in the moment, but I'm not driving. What are we going to do? So this guy beeps on the horn, and what does he do? He swerves around us. He speeds past us, and guess what? Justice. There's a red light. So he's parked at the red light, and we come up right next to him. I mean right next to him. I mean right on that double, you know, the hash right next to him. And then we're front wheel to front wheel. And big old Stone just kind of looks at him. Like, I got something for you if you want some of this. And I'm like, Stone, don't do it. Stone, why are you so close to him? Because of Dad. Right? Now Dad's trying to teach him something else. So the guy, after the lights turn green, he speeds off and gets in the far left lane because he saw somebody meant business. I said, Stone, we don't have to live this way. Your dad has been wrong. I taught you the wrong way of doing it. Vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the Lord. I need to let the Lord handle him, and I need to trust him. He's holy, he's righteous, he's present, he's in the room. I have to yield and submit to him right now. My hand open is a sign. Like if you come up on me with a problem and I open my hand, you know that I'm like, Lord, you have to, I will trust you with this moment right now, whatever it is. And maybe for you right now, Remy, the moment is Ryan. I don't know. But listen, maybe you need to, go ahead, Remy, let me see it. Ryan? Give me one of these. Can you give? What does this mean? What does this mean? I'm praying. I'm worshiping. His presence is right here. His power is right here. What do I need to do? I need to submit. Am I just going over this too much? No. Because we need it. And this is what he wants. But what has to happen first? Listen to this. Listen to Psalms 32. Listen to what it says. Psalms 32, this is in the NIV. Psalms 32 says this, verse 1. Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Listen to the verse 2. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against him. Do you understand what that verse means? That individual is classified as just and righteous, and he sins. And God does not what? He does not count that sin against him. I love that verse. I want to be that guy. I want to be that guy. I want to be considered just and righteous. And the Lord does not count sin against me, in whose spirit is no deceit. Well, what has to take place in my life before I can experience that? What had to take place in my life before I opened my hand and said, Lord, I will let you drive, even though somebody else is driving. I'm going to let you drive. I'm going to trust in you. What had to happen in my life? I had to come under conviction, didn't I? I had to realize and I had to understand I'm a sinner. I'm failing in this area. This area in my life is wrong. I cannot continue to do this. I don't like who I am. I don't want to be this person anymore. I want power in my life. I need this power. It is the power of God to salvation for everyone who what? Who believes. I want this. What has to take place first? Look at verse 5. Psalms 32. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. This is sin in my life. This is iniquity in my life. This is wrong. I'm a Christian, and all of a sudden, sin is sneaking back into my life. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. Listen to what David said. I said, I will confess my transgression to the Lord. And what did he do? And you forgave the guilt of my sin. I love that. God not only forgives your sin, he not only forgives your trespass, he not only forgives your iniquity, he forgives your guilt and your shame, and he removes your shame. But what do you have to come to? You have to come to the place where you say, I will confess my transgression before the Lord. I don't care if you're a believer, I don't care if you're an unbeliever. This is where we have to start. This is what the gospel is. It's an individual saying, I'm going to confess. This is not working in my life. I cannot continue to do this. Over here, let's go back to Romans 1 and verse 16. Over here, it says this. I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is what? It's the power of God to do what? To save. For everyone who does what? Believes. Now look at verse 17. Look at verse 17. Listen to what it says. For in it, the righteousness of God is revealed from what? What did we say? From faith to faith. And then what does it say? It says, the just will live by faith. What does faith look like in your life? It looks like you come to the place where you say, I have transgressed. I am wrong. This is wrong. I cannot continue this. Lord, you must save me. And what does he do? He not only forgives your sin, he forgives the guilt and the shame of your sin. That's powerful. And then he says this. This is the way I want you to live. I call you just. Now, listen, theologians are not going to like this. So if you're a theologian today, go like this. La, 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 la. Close your ears. Just, remember this. In God's eyes, just or righteous is just as if you have never sinned. From where you sit, God says, I call you just, and it is just as if you never sinned. Isn't that powerful? That God would look at you that way. Now also, from God's perspective, when he looks at Christ, it's not just as if we ever sinned, right? He laid on Christ the iniquity of us all. He poured his wrath and his punishment on Christ, right? That was a horrible thing. He had to put, so it's not just as if I never sinned. From Christ's perspective, Because he had to bear all of that punishment for us on our behalf. So I understand the theologians when they discuss and have a problem with it. But from our perspective, God looks at us and says, you are the righteousness of Christ. Blessed is the man whose sin the Lord does not hold against them. Whew, I want to be that guy. That's who I want to be. But it comes to the place where we make the statement, I can't live this way anymore. I'm tired of living in fear. Name it. What is it in your life that you lack power in? We acknowledge his presence. We acknowledge him to be who he is. We worship him. We concentrate on him. We recognize who he is. And in the moment, we say, Lord, I yield to you. I submit to you. I give you, fill in the blank, whatever it is. And you know what I always like to add? I'm not going to stop talking to you until this temptation goes away. I will not stop talking to you. And what does 1 Corinthians 10:13 say? There's no trial, no temptation has taken you but what is common to man. But God is faithful. He will not allow you to be tested or tempted above that you're, but God is faithful. Isn't that good? But God is faithful. But he will with the temptation make a way of escape so that you might be able to hold up and bear under it. This is the answer. But I have to come to the place just like I did when I first got saved. And I have to say these words. I'm not going to hide my sin from God. I'm not going to hide my transgression from him. I'm going to confess to him what it is. And I'm going to trust in him. I'm going to trust in him. Plain and simple, that's what it is. And you know what this is? This is the just as if you never sinned, living by faith. This is what it means when it says, from faith to faith. This is the way we live our life. It's very basic, it's very simple, and it's a total dependency on Christ. Be careful when you start to get all full of yourself. Christ says, that has no place in my life. Be careful about pride. This is what I'm describing is the opposite of pride. Lord, I can't, but I know through you I can. Life verse. I can do Philippians 4:13 on the front row. I can do some things through Christ. I can do through Christ. That's a verse that stands alone. That's a verse we need for our whole life. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And I don't know what it was. It should have kept working, holding his hand. It should have kept working. But I'm telling you, this afternoon, something happens. There's like a Sunday afternoon preacher letdown. And usually about 5 or 6 o'clock, once it starts getting dark, all of a sudden the fear starts moving in for me. I don't know why. It's just, I start imagining things that don't exist. And magically, by Monday morning, they're all gone, right? What do I have to do? Acknowledge his presence. I believe Romans is all connected as well. He says in Romans 12, he says, I beg you, I beseech you by the mercies of God that you commit your bodies as a living sacrifice. Holy, acceptable to God. This is your reasonable act of worship. That's what I've just described to you, submitting to him. And don't be conformed to this world, but be what? Be transformed by the renewing of your mind that you might find what is that good and perfect and pleasing will of God that he has planned for us. But first it begins with us acknowledging, I cannot, you must. I don't know about you. Can you say this? I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God to salvation to those who believe. Let's all stand together. Maybe there's some areas in your life that you need that power in. It's a simple thing. It takes a lot of work, though, doesn't it? It takes a lot of work. So when those areas come up, and you're going to be tempted in those areas, God's asking you to submit to Him and yield to Him. But maybe you're here this morning and you've never heard that message before. Maybe you've heard about Christ or who He is, but you've never heard that you need personally to come to that place in your life where you say, Lord, I acknowledge my sin before You. And Lord, I turn to You and I need forgiveness. I need this shame to be removed from me. If that's you, it is a simple thing of you in your heart saying, Lord, I choose You. Lord, forgive me of my sin and what I've done. Just turn to Him and say, Lord, forgive me. Forgive me for what I've done. Simple thing. And what does He do? What does David say in Psalms 32? He forgives our iniquity. He forgives our shame. Ah, there's no better message. There's no better message. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank You. We praise You this morning. Lord, for the promises that come from Your word, the goodness that comes from Your word. Lord, we thank You for what You have planned for us this week. You have planned for us victory and not defeat. You've planned for us this week salvation. And Father, You're waiting on us. Just like Paul, as he urged us and he begged us to lay down our lives and yield it to You in that moment. Father, we thank You that You offer this to us. Thank You, Lord, that You said You've come into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world through You might be saved. We praise You for this, Lord, and we thank You. We thank You in Jesus' name. Amen.
Mother's womb, You formed me with Your hands, known and loved by You. Before I took a breath, when I doubted, Lord, remind me, I'm wonderfully made. You're an artist and a potter, I'm the canvas and the clay. You make all things work together for my future and for my good. You make all things work together for Your glory and for Your name. There's a healing light just beyond the clouds. Though I've walked through fire, I see clearly now. I know nothing has been wasted, no failure or mistake. You're an artist and a potter, on the canvas and the clay. You make all things work together for my future and for my good. You make all things work together for Your glory and for Your name. I'm a canvas and the clay. I know nothing has been wasted, no failure or mistake. You're an artist and a potter, I'm a canvas and the clay. You make all things work together for my future and for my good. You make all for your glory and for your Lord, remind me, I'm wonderfully made. 'Cause you're an artist and a potter. I'm the canvas and the clay. I know nothing has been wasted, no failure or mistake. 'Cause you're an artist and a potter. I'm the canvas and the clay. You're an artist and a potter. I'm the canvas and the clay. You're the artist and the potter. I'm the canvas and the clay.
Lord, thank you so much for being here with us this morning as we worship you and lift you on high. Please cultivate your love into our lives as we leave your house today to share the word of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, so much for gathering us together. We ask this in your name. Amen. Please join us Wednesday night. We do have Bible study 6:30. We look forward to seeing you then. Have a blessed and wonderful week.